That was incredible, bro. Super iconic.
That's a little bromance, man, you know.
The greatest human act is to inspire.
Watching him inspires me. We're in good hands.
Dream that highest dream.
That's what I'm about to do.
Michael B. Jordan School of Art. I see that.
Your name, People's Sexiest Man Alive.
It's really just letting all my homies, my boys, just roast me whenever they want to.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the second episode of Coach Conversations, a monthly YouTube series where we get to talk about the things that impact our lives, our culture, and our community. I'm Lindsay Peoples Wagner, editor-in-chief at New York Magazine's The Cut. And on this episode, we're talking about what it means to be a Black creative, how they're making an impact in their respective industries, as well as opening doors for the next generation. Our first guest is one of the entertainment world's biggest talents, actor, producer, philanthropist, and most recently named People Magazine's Sexiest Man Alive. Of course, none other than Michael B. Jordan.
Hey, what's going on? Pleasure to be here. Thanks for moderating this for us and having this conversation.
Oh, of course. And our next guest is one of the music industry's most exciting young stars, Grammy-nominated rapper and wise beyond his age. When he's not making music, you can see him on the front lines for the Black community, speaking up and making impact in our community. Say hello to Cordae.
Hey, what's up, y'all? How's it going?
Before we start, why don't you tell everybody about yourself, Lindsay, and what you've accomplished thus far, you know, all the bars that you've been setting and changing the game in your own right.
Yeah, I mean, I had actually interned and worked at Teen Vogue before becoming editor-in-chief, and now I'm actually moving to New York Magazine The Cut, where I also used to intern and assist as well. And so I'm super excited to be one of the only Black women in the industry, you know, running a publication, and it's a huge honor. And, you know, within the fashion community, there's, you know, such a lack of inclusivity, and so I'm really excited to continue to make those changes.
I guess in my own respective lane,
yeah,
it was like a similar approach, you know, starting at, you know, at the lowest level within my field, and then just kind of working my way up, like falling in love with it. But as you're working into it, you're like, you're seeing all the holes, you're seeing the gaps, you're seeing the flaws, and when you finally get like some momentum and you get like a little weight to throw around, where you can actually start making an impact on a small level, and then that levels up. Then you make an impact on a bigger level, and you know, and so on and so forth.
I love it.
And just to tell you a little bit about why this brother's sitting here,
yeah,
I was doing a press tour for like Just Mercy.
By the way, bro, incredible role, bro.
Oh, man,
like,
appreciate it, man.
You did that. The Bryan Stevenson, that was incredible, bro.
Man,
like,
respect,
super bro. Iconic.
Nah, thank you, man. Like, honestly, working with Jamie, you know, we really pushed each other, you know what I'm saying, on set, and Jamie Foxx's. But he's the one who introduced us.
Oh, yep, exactly.
And then we swapped numbers that day, and then we just kind of, you know, been in touch ever since. You know, it's very rarely nowadays when, like, people, like, you know, say pull up. So we actually started hanging out a bit, and just re-inspires me. So we kind of, you know, created this bond, and I thought it would be, like, no better person to kind of have him here having this conversation, because he's doing exactly, you know, the same thing I'm doing, but in a different genre, but it's all universal.
Nah, for sure. And he's definitely been like a big brother, you know what I'm saying, like, to me in this thing. And somebody I can always call, you know, for advice, you know, just somebody to always that's going to keep it 100 with me, bro. And that's something that I don't take for granted. I really, like, appreciate that shit.
Nah,
bro.
Real,
like,
shit, man. I'm here, man. That's a little bromance, man, you know.
How do you both deal with, you know, I think for me it's so interesting when you're a Black creative, but also people want to pigeonhole you because you're Black. How do you both, you know, deal with that as we're artists and creatives and just making work and also trying to make all these changes?
For me, it's like, it's an intentional thing. My approach to it, you know, and I think people have taken this out of context sometimes and not really understanding the mentality behind it. But I think it was a certain point where, you know, I told my team I only want to go out for roles that was not written for, you know what I'm saying, African-American. I wasn't written on the page as Black. Because inherently, when I get that role, you know, I'm going to make it me. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to put, you know, like, I can't change this. This is who I am. Like, that character is going to become me. Sometimes writers write with bias. You know what I'm saying? They're writing their interpretation or their perspective of what Black is supposed to be. And sometimes that's not always authentic. It's very stereotypical. So, like, that was my approach to, like, yo, I want a role that, you know, Ben Affleck or Tom Cruise or Leonardo DiCaprio was going to play. I want that role, you know what I'm saying? And let me take that character. It doesn't have to be that line in the sand of being like, oh, you're the Black actor, you know what I'm saying? Why can't I just be an actor? What about, what you feel about that?
Yeah, you know, there's such a massive stereotype on rappers, right? And, you know, one, we're artists, right? And, it's just so many things that I see what people are expecting from me, like even when I'm speaking at an event or, you know, everybody's expecting me to be late, you know, versus being on time or it's just a massive amount of, you know, negative stereotypes that come with being an artist when you're interacting with people, you know, from the outside world, you get what I'm saying? But if you really, like, talk to other people that's within my field, within my genre, it's, like, just full of young, intelligent brothers.
Yeah.
Trailblazing, and let's get rid of these things. Like, why can't I be an artist and a rapper and they be the head of coach, you get what I'm saying? Or get into production with films and movie scripts. So you're sort of boxed into this thing, you get what I'm saying? And so just opening up, you know, the full palette of creativity in so many different lanes.
And that's a weight, it's a weight, it's a pressure that you put on yourself,
you
know what I'm saying? Because you want to raise the bar, you got to change people's minds, you know what I'm saying? Perspectives of you, it really doesn't happen unless you walk through it unapologetically who you are and not scared to walk your truth on a daily basis, you know what I mean? So that's something that I think we all three of us have in common, you know what I mean? In our own respective fields.
Unapologetically.
It's like, you know, you're gonna see me for what I am and who I am, not what you think I am, you know what I mean? And I think that's something that we gotta, you know, that we gotta continue to do because we're definitely setting an example.
Yeah, I mean, I think we don't talk enough about the fear and the pressures that come with it. And Cordae, I once read a tweet of yours where you mentioned overthinking as another form of fear.
That's deep.
Yeah, nah, for real. So definitely overthinking is another form of fear. And, you know, I don't really tweet like that, but I had to tweet that because it was a bar. I came with, you know what I'm saying? So I feel like this can help a lot of people because I overthink a lot.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's a blessing and, you know, a curse at the same time because in order to really be creative or with anything in life, you know, you have to put thought into it. But it's finding that balance between going with your gut and your intuition and trusting that intuition versus overthinking. Because most of the time when you're overthinking, you're thinking about exactly. It comes from doubt. You know, that's something we talked about. You just like, bruh, you just gotta go with that first initial gut and believe in yourself and know you here for a purpose and just run through that. You get what I'm saying?
Yep. Do you ever get like writer's block, Lindsay? Like, or do you still think like your instinct is the best like decision maker for you to get like an honest response to what you're looking for?
I think especially with social media, it's just made it hard because everyone expects you to have a well-informed, educated opinion on a subject right away. And so a lot of times I feel like when I'm writing about something, I just need more time. I just need to, you know, I need to think about it a little more and not just have this like instantaneous reaction to everything that, you know, should be critiqued and everybody talk about. And I think that, you know, that pressure can be a lot, but I also just feel like when you are a Black creative, and especially in the fashion industry, and there aren't that many people of color in executive roles, you feel like you're just shouldering the weight of so many other people. And so it's really important when you do write that you say something that is really impacting people's lives. I mean, I journal a ton and just try to write a ton so that when I do, when we are writing or, you know, putting together something, that I at least have a lot of thoughts and can spend some time to figure out the best way to go about it.
Oh, that's dope, because that's something I literally started doing at the beginning of last year. My mom was like, yo, your life is like so incredible. You know what I'm saying? We got all these blessings, you know, traveling, touring the world and things of that nature. She was like, you need to start writing a journal about things, like things you see on a daily. So that's, I just sort of related with that because I've been starting to do that a lot lately, just writing down my experiences and things of that nature.
Yeah, that's on my to-do. I think it's something that, like you said, it's easier said than done, but like really just taking the time to
sit out there. You gotta do it.
Like, really, exactly.
I mean, I think also so much of all of our work, you know, is part of our, you know, part of our personality, part of who we are as creatives. And so much of our work is part of our personal lives and emotional. And I think just it requires so much of you. So, Michael, do you think about your work, you know, living beyond your time and just the weight of it and the legacy that you want to have within the industry?
Definitely. I think legacy for me is something I think about often. You know what I mean? Life is short. You know what I mean? We have, you know, this past year, I think, has really shown me and us and all of us, you can't really take things for granted. You know what I'm saying? You can't take your opportunity, your blessings, your, you know what I'm saying, the time that you have. You can't really take that for granted. So make it count. Make it mean something. So, yeah, legacy is something I definitely think about. Like my production company, you know, having like a fellowship, you know what I'm saying? Trying to set up key things that are in place that's gonna last longer than my physical body. You know what I mean? You trying to build things that, you know, are gonna continue to feed and to pour into people. You know, I just started this thing, Hoop Dreams Classic, you know what I'm saying? Which is gonna be around HBCUs, you know, like an invitational to be able to give platforms to like, you know, HBCUs in a bigger way.
That's incredible, bro.
Appreciate it, man.
That's incredible.
And it's, thank you, but it's little things like that, you know, that I think you know, I want to grow and nurture, you know what I'm saying, to become bigger. You know
Michael
what I mean?
B. Jordan School of Art. I see that. For real. For real.
I appreciate that,
for
man.
For real, we need that.
If anything, I put it in my mom's name, man. I put my shit in the fine print in the back. You know
what
I'm saying?
Yeah, nah, for real.
I want the name to be something that's universal, that can, without any bias. I like playing the back seat sometimes and watching the other go-getters and putting other people in position to win.
That's real.
I was gonna say, I don't know how you can do that after your name, People's Sexiest Man Alive.
Oh man, we just talk about that, man. It's a gift and a curse, I swear.
You got 6 more months, bro.
It's really just letting all my homies, my boys, just roast me whenever they want to. They have a clear lane at heckling me as much as possible. But yeah, it's cool.
So there's the creative field and, you know, your work as a creative, but then there's your values and beliefs as a human, you know, and obviously as Black people, you know, this past year has been really tough. There's been so many days where I just felt like, how am I going to keep it together? After, you know, George Floyd was murdered and Breonna Taylor, it just felt like there was just so much, you know, weighing on all of us and that there weren't enough changes happening. And Cordae, you know, I know that both of you actually showed up at protests, Cordae in Kentucky, and I know, Michael, you showed up in L.A. So, you know, what made you want to show up and take on, you know, more of an activist and public role? Because I know that really is a big decision and that means a lot to both of you.
I've always been involved, always, you know, had a hand in, in some type of a fashion. This is how I was raised, you know. You know, anybody know my parents, you know, they know that, you know, I'm definitely their child, you know. And I think this particular time, it was, everything was sitting still, you know. It was at a time where, like, there weren't as many distractions. It wasn't as much going, everybody was like, it was a solidarity that kind of like started to really form that we haven't seen in a really long time, where people didn't have any excuses not to see or pay attention and kind of like, you know, and I think it weighed on me a lot heavier than it has in the past. And, you know, being in a place where I could use my platform and, you know, and call on, you know, my partners, you know, across my industry, when it, from brands to studios to agencies to, you know, whoever I'm doing business with, you know, if they're doing business with me, you got to understand my values and things that I care about, and you got to show up for that as much as I'm showing up for that studio, that brand. And the response was overwhelming, you know what I'm saying? Like, made me feel like the people that I chose to partner with, that we chose to collaborate with, was about substance. It's going to continue. Like, that wasn't the first step, but that was a step. And we got a lot of work to do, so. And I know you kind of feel the same.
Yeah, for sure, definitely. It's like the same what you said. Like, my mom had me reading, I was like 10 years old reading A. Philip Randolph, like Thurgood Marshall, Revolutionary Suicide. I was like a teenager reading these things. And so it's just something that's always been embedded within me.
Yep.
And so, you know, even back in 2015 when I was in high school with Philando Castile and, you know, all the same thing, Mike Brown, the same thing essentially going on today was happening, you know, we was out there as well. And so it's just something that's always been embedded within my DNA. And the only difference is now, you know, we have a platform. It's our duty and our responsibility to make sure that our voices get heard. And that's the origin of hip hop, the original purpose of hip hop was the voice of the voiceless. You get what I'm saying? And so it's sort of carrying on that lineage through that and, you know, what you're doing that as well. And it's just about, you know, inspiring the next and laying the path.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, I think what's really important about this conversation that we all realize is that, you know, having these kind of conversations and I think, you know, making sure to, you know, keep applying the pressure as far as Black Lives Matter, we want to make this not just like a moment in time. We want to make sure that people aren't just, you know, committed to these changes for an Instagram post. We want people to actually be committed to this movement and really, you know, be serious about long-term change and sustainable change over time. So, I mean, it's about the work and the platform your career gives you, but it's also about building off of it and beyond it and really staying true to who we are as Black creatives, so.
Mm. Yep, I agree.
So what would you tell younger folks that look up to both of you, watching how you move, watching the decisions you make? Cordae, what would you say to younger folks that are looking up to you right now?
Man, you know, it's funny. I just got off a Zoom with the Boys and Girls Club, yesterday, and one of the things I miss about touring is that...
Oh, I used to be at the Boys and Girls Club.
Yeah, for sure, same. So,
same here, yep.
So one of the things I miss about tour was, in every city, I would make it a point to go to like a local like middle school to, you know, speak to the young kings and queens and just give whatever, you know, small amount of knowledge and guidance that I have, because, you know, I don't have all the answers in the grand scheme of things, but just passing on what, you know, little information I have, let them know to dream your biggest dream and just move with absolute no fear. Don't let anybody's, you know, doubt or negativity become your own, you know, like really like write down your goals, manifest, you know, your affirmations and attack it daily. And, you know, what you were speaking on earlier is legacy mm-hmm. is the biggest thing. You know, my ultimate goal is to get into the Hip Hop Hall of Fame. And so everything I do now just leads into that.
Yes.
And I tell the kids to apply that in whatever career field, whether they want to be an architect, lawyer, doctor, is to dream that highest dream and take it as far as you want to go.
Yeah,
definitely.
Man, what about you? That's deep, man. That's why, I love you, bro. Like, nah, that's the type of mentality you got to have, man, and not be, you know, precious with information.
You know, to quote one of the greats, is the greatest human act is to inspire. So, and I know I can speak the same for Michael as well as you, Lindsay. Our biggest goal is to, you know, inspire the next generation and spark that next brain, you know.
Watching him inspires me. You know, like seeing what he's doing, how like fearless he is, like everything you set your mind to, you're gonna achieve. Like I have no doubt about that, man. Yeah, it means a lot. I think for kids, you know, people that look up, I think it's finding what works for them to feel like it could be them too. Mm. You know what I mean? It, why not you? And I think just trying to bridge that gap between their minds and their doubt of like, you know, that can never be me to like, no, it's quite possible because I was just like you. And also just be serious about something. I think it's really easy to like let a day go by, a week go by, a month go by, and not really put any time into something that is going to like, you know, bear fruits later on down the road. So like, you know, there's so many distractions out here, you know what I'm saying? From social media to like just the random entertainment in it. And people don't sometimes realize that that's a design to keep us distracted. You know what I'm saying? To keep our eye off the ball. But if you spend a little quiet time, you know what I mean? Meditation, mental health is big, it's huge. Mm-hmm. To be able to sit still and think about the things that you really want to manifest, you can really impose your will on things. You know what I'm saying? You can manifest things to happen. So that's the kind of like the you know what I'm saying, little gems I try to leave behind for, you know, for this next generation.
No, I love that. Thank you both so much. Now we have a few rapid fire questions, so this will be fun. So let me know the first thing that comes to your mind.
What's one thing that you can't live without?
Probably music. Okay. I know that's hella cliche.
That's fair.
But for real, yeah. What's your first thoughts when waking up?
It's too simultaneously.
Uh-oh.
Oh shit, am I late?
I thought that this morning.
I was late.
And what do I have to do today? What about you?
I'm like, did I forget to answer that email? And somebody's about to be like, I need you to do this immediately. And I'm not, I need coffee in the morning. So I just like, right when I wake up, I'm like, oh God, like what's happening right now? Cordae, what keeps you motivated?
My family, like my mom. Seeing my mom like raise me and my younger brother like all by herself in fearlessness, you get what I'm saying? So whenever I think, oh, like, man, I done did 20 straight hours in the studio and then I gotta come do this the next day, it's like, nah, bro, it's nothing, you know? And my legacy.
That's deep. What was the last book you read?
I'm almost done with A Promised Land from Barack Obama.
Okay.
It's very good.
If you were an actor, what person would you want to play?
And I'd be Creed. I was just reading, I want to be James Baldwin. I was just reading The Fire next time. I think I can do a decent job of playing James Baldwin. I had to cut the head.
Transform a bit, exactly.
Read some more, get my vernacular up there.
That's inspiring, then, brother. I can see that.
All right, Lindsay, if you started a magazine, what would be the name of it?
I've actually thought about this a lot, and I don't have a name, but it would just be something about Black women being the best gift to this planet.
Facts. Let me see. All right, I got one for you. If you was a rapper, What would your rap name be?
Oh, you don't put me on the spot. I got nothing.
It's all right. We'll figure it out.
We'll work on that.
Thinking so hard. I'm like, you actually trying to become a rapper?
You know he on the next album, right? Can he tell you?
Well, Mike, Cordae, thank you both for being here and having this conversation. Coach, thank you so much for bringing this to life. And to all of you, thank you so much for watching.
Yeah, appreciate it.